Right, hello everyone. First, I do have a correction. I wish it was 30 million copies, but we are close to 7 right now, which is still tremendous, but we're working our way up to 30. So today I will talk about how it's possible to create a very successful game with a very small studio, let's call it that way, and by studio I mean my brother and myself, through employing really a lot of the points that Chris was talking about earlier in the intro speech. So I took a picture of his slide. So you know, one of the things he was talking about was write and sell by the level, and that's, as you'll see from my presentation, exactly what we've been doing, creating small pieces of content that we would then release every couple of weeks to the App Store. And that way, people were sort of getting the content one piece at a time, rather than 2 million levels all at the same time. Digital distribution angle, it's all digital for us. And you know, the downloadable content, it's not necessarily something we have done yet, but a lot of our friends on the App Store have been able to very successfully use that model to actually monetize their games and their apps. Right? And we have this claim. Multi-screen access is something that was mentioned as well, and we are moving Doodle Jump from the iPhone to other devices and so on. So that will be a core of what I'll be talking about. But before we begin, what I would like to show you is a little introductory movie about what Doodle Jump is, and it's actually a mockumentary, which means it was done by Doodle Jump fans. 15-year-old kids in France who just love the game, but it really speaks so much about what it is and how it's played. So let's see that. So, you know, what's great about this day and age is that we could have paid money to have this produced. Instead, we got it for free from someone on the web, and they love that, you know, we're showing it and then we're using it in promotional purposes. So, when my brother and I were Lorenzo's age, we were actually quite driven by inspiration, not necessarily creating Doodle Jump yet. One of the first things we started with, as you can see here, is the Sinclair ZX Spectrum. And I'm really happy that I'm presenting this here in the UK, where people actually know what that is. So, you know, we were like 13, 14 years old. We were creating our own game right there, all on a piece of paper in a notebook, because back then we needed to find a publisher who would actually put it on the tape and sell it. And the summer was over, we went back to school, the game never happened. We did quite a few things in the years between our first venture into the ZX Spectrum game to the point where we created Doodle Jump and started working on the iOS platform. From websites to photography to video to publishing, all kinds of different things. And my brother has also been doing a lot of work in the mobile gaming space. I was in New York, he was in Zagreb, Croatia. And we've always looked for angles to work together somehow. And then 2 years ago, Apple introduced the App Store. They opened up the App Store to third-party applications, and my brother and I decided, let's give it a try. Let's come together and see if we can create some apps. It'll be fun, right? So the first thing we decided to do was this bubble wrap simulator. Very simple concept, something that we can create, we were hoping, in a couple of days, and turned out it would take us a month or two because we had no idea what we were doing, because we never actually programmed for the Mac before. We figured it's so simple that it could actually get some media attention because it's silly. And we also figured people would be willing to pay 99 cents for it. That has always been our model. Really low cost, because all it cost us was the computers that we already had, and $100 that Apple was charging for the developer program fee. And to tell you the truth, even those $100, we were thinking, well, should we pay or not? Will we make it back? We had no idea, right? The second thing we did, again, was simple, tic-tac-toe game, something that has existed. But what we did was apply this sort of hand-drawn style to it that people can relate to, and made it a little different from some of the other tic-tac-toes that were there. To our surprise, both of those actually sold pretty well. Not millions, not even hundreds of thousands, but you know, the bubble wrap sold 60 copies the first day, which turns out to be $40. But part of the problem with that was also that it wasn't on the top, because it took some time for Apple to approve our contracts and so on. In other words, it would have sold more had the situation been better when it initially launched. I think tic-tac-toe sold maybe 200 copies a day when it launched. So that was July 2008. There were 500 apps on the entire App Store. You could actually go through the entire list in about 15 minutes. Anything you would put up on the store, it would sell. We were not on the top of the list, so we weren't one of the first Gold Rush stories, but we were definitely looking at this and seeing a great potential, saying, there can be some money made here, and we can have a lot of fun doing it. However, as time passed, and as the stories were starting to come out about how great this new platform was, and how easy, let's say, it is to make money, bigger players came in, started to release games that had really great graphics, really deep gameplay, multiple levels, hundreds or hours of gameplay with different things to it. And I got scared, and that was I think around December 2008, and one of the things was this digital chocolate product here that just looked so beautiful. And I was thinking, we can never match that look. There's only two of us, and they're a big company. And let's see what we can do. Let's see how we can sort of separate ourselves from that cutthroat competition that we really cannot compete in. I mean, there's no way we can create a 3D engine and create all the graphics around that. So instead, we decided to actually focus on simple games. Games that were geared for kids initially. AnyMatch was a great example of that, which is actually our second bestseller after Doodle Jump right now. Very simple memory matching game where the kids have to find the match of animal heads, and the animals make their little sounds when we switch them. Kids love it. It's very simple but effective. A very much a predecessor to Doodle Jump is this Eat Bunny Eat thing, which all it does is you tilt the iPhone to move the little rabbit left and right, catch the carrots, avoid the cans. Very similar to, you know, some of the games that were back in the days on Ataris and so on. But it actually was a huge hit here in Britain. There was, you know, one of the comments we got early in the summer 2008 again was that from someone in, I think in London, saying that this game is already making its rounds around the pub. Everyone was trying to better each other's scores and screaming, "Eat, buddy, eat!" And I could just imagine the scene of, you know, people drinking a pint and playing this game. And you know, you wake up in the morning and you read that, and that gives you the energy to go. It's just incredible that level of connection you have with people and what kind of impact those simple things make. So some of you, I'm sure, are familiar with this called Blue Ocean Strategy theory, and where, you know, the idea is not to try and compete in a crowded space, but sort of carve out this little space for you where you are sort of the only player. And kids apps were something that we were looking at. Simple apps were something that we were looking at there. One of the problems we had was, or one of the sort of dilemmas was, will people actually be willing to give a $500 device to their kids? And turns out they would do it in a second, because kids get quiet when you need them to get quiet in a restaurant when they're waiting for something, and they love it. But again, you know, kids market is a very limited market. So we try to continue with that sort of appeal, something that would appeal to kids, but would also appeal to everyone else. And that's partially how Doodle Jump got born. It was going to be a sequel to the Eat Bunny Eat game, where we would have this little bunny jumping up the platforms because bunnies jump, right? But we couldn't get the graphics quite right. It wasn't necessarily appealing to a wide enough audience. And you know, what started with just placeholders for the platforms somehow ended up in the final look because we liked it so much. It sort of went together with the first app, one of the first apps that we did with tic-tac-toe, which is all the graph paper hand-drawn. And we figured, you know, no one has really done that style yet. It's such a drastic move from a realistic 3D images to this hand-drawn thing. And another thing we were looking at or thinking about is what Nintendo did with the Wii. When they came out with a console that was sort of taking a step back in terms of graphics power and processing power, but really focused on the gameplay. That's what we tried to accomplish with Doodle Jump. And we created a game, we put it up on the store, and we were nervously expecting to see what it will sell. 21 copies. Okay. So this was March 2009 already. The days of you put it on the App Store and it sells, obviously, have gone past. We actually haven't done any pre-promotion of the game, nothing. Our expectation was, we'll put it up, it will sell because it's so great. However, that really didn't happen. It was probably one of the worst launches we've ever had, including some of the games that sold maybe 200 copies in their entire life. So we got, you know, we got to work. We started emailing every single blog out there about the game. We started some serious PR machinery, but I don't mean actually hiring a PR firm. What I mean is me sitting down, sending emails to every single blog out there to get some notice. And eventually we got Touch Arcade to write about it. We got Gizmodo to notice it. We got Apple to notice it as well, because we had some really interesting features in the game that no one has done before.